Why does that keep happening? Wait till I get older. Yeah. I won't start all the way over, but I will just say tonight is the ecumenical lessons and carols service at City Hall at 5 o'clock. If you're feeling like singing and praying and listening to the Christmas story with other Waupun area churches, please be welcome to join us for that. It was a really lovely service last year, and it looks like it's going to be a great time this year. Announcement that I know that I have is that there are lots of sign up sheets for various things. We've got Salvation Army bell ringing. We've got liturgist sign up galore, because on Christmas Eve we have 5 slots because there are lots of readings, and I would love to have a real diversity of different voices leading us in scripture for those services. So if you if that's your thing, even if you've never done it before, if it's your thing, be welcome to sign up and do that for us and with us. Becky, you've got some announcements?
Good morning. I just wanted to let you know that the shoe drive went over really, really well. Amber McLean from Reach Waupun came on Friday and picked up like 2/3 of the shoes that she thought she could place with the kids at Meadowview and Rock River. I am going to take another bunch over to the high school for some of the bigger kids, and also the rest then will go to the food pantry. So I just wanted to thank this congregation for their generosity. It was really well received, and they thought it was just wonderful. I also wanted to say thank you for your help with the Giving Tree. I think last I looked, and I didn't look this morning, there were 3 tags left that for real general things, so they're easy. We'll take those Giving Tree gifts through Sunday the 17th. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Becky. Any other announcements this morning? Very good. Let's join together in the call to worship.
Please stand if you're able and join me in the call to worship. God is compassionate to the suffering of those most vulnerable. God is sending Jesus for the liberation of the people. So today, we will make a way for Jesus to come, bringing love, joy, hope, and peace to a world of need. Join me in the opening prayer. God of expectation, we thank you for gathering us together from wherever we are. Help us prepare our hearts for the coming of your justice and love. Help us embody your hope and love wherever we go. Amen.
Amen. So our opening hymn is number 180, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. Now Deanne Goodlaxon is going to light the Advent candle for us.
We rejoice that Christmas is a time of prayer and of open hearts when we sing songs of joy. Christmas is a time of worship, the moment when the busy of us pause in wonder. Christmas happens when God comes to us in love through Jesus Christ and fills us with love for all humankind. From John, 1 John 4, 9 through 11, this is how the love of God is revealed to us. God has sent God's only Son into the world so that we can live through him. This is love. It is not that we love God, but that God loved us and sent God's Son as a sacrifice that deals with our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us this way, we also ought to love each other. We light this candle to proclaim the coming of the light of God into the world. With the coming of this light, there is love. Such great love helps us to love God and one another. Please pray with me. Oh God, we thank you that Jesus showed your love for every person, babies and children, and old people and young, sick people and those who were rich, those who were strong, rich people and those who were poor. Come to us in this Advent season and give us love in our hearts for all people. Amen.
Thank you, Deanne. So we're going to join together in our Advent candle lighting song. We're going to be singing verses 1 and 2 today. So we started with hope last week, and we will sing, we'll add love this week. So now comes the time where we, let's see, what time is it? It is children's time. All right, so now comes the time where we share some time with young worshipers, so come on up.
Come on up. We're going to meet over here by the nativity scene today. Can you take a good look? Take a good look at the nativity scene up here. Okay. Don't sit down yet. All right. Okay. Do you see Mary? Yeah. Do you see Joseph? Okay. Do you think? All right. Let's see. Do we see a shepherd in there somewhere? Way in the back with a sheep on his shoulders? Okay. Way in the back. You see them? Okay. Do you see the... Oh, yeah, there's two shepherds. Oh, we're going to need lots of helpers today. We might need Trey to come up and help us. We have some kings. Are these the three kings over here? Sure. All right. There's something missing, though. Whoa. Where's Jesus? Is he? Do you see him? Looks like there's an empty spot there. Why isn't Jesus here yet? Do you know why Jesus isn't here yet?
Because he wasn't born yet.
He's right, isn't he? When's his birthday? Anybody know when his birthday is?
Christmas,
yeah. Good job. Okay, so what we're going to do is create the nativity scene, and I'm going to need some helpers. You guys all ready to help me? Oh, good. All right, let's take the three kings. Okay, let Kathy hold it really carefully, okay? We don't want to break them. We're going to walk over. Okay. Then we need one of the shepherds, and we need Mary and Joseph. Do you think some of you big kids could carry two if you're really careful? Okay. Go by Kathy. She'll hand you a second one. Mary and Joseph. Okay. We're going to walk really carefully over by the windows. Okay. Let's go down the main center aisle. That might be easier. It's bigger. Careful not to trip over each other. Okay, come on back. If you have one of the kings came from so far away, we call it Orient R in the song, right? We three kings of Orient R. I don't know where Orient R is. Do you? I don't know. Maybe someone in the congregation can help us find Orient R. All right. So, we need one king right here. Can you set it really careful? Okay, and we'll push it back so nobody bumps it on their way out of church. We need another king way back here. Okay, we'll make him facing the way he's going here. Okay, and the third king we'll put right here. Oops, be really careful. Okay, and we'll push them all back. All right, we're going to let Kathy come up to the past you. Okay. Okay, let's move up a window here. Okay, the shepherds were a little closer. So we'll put, really gentle, good job. Let's push them all the way back so nobody bumps it with an elbow as they're walking out. You can push them all the way back to the window. That way no one bumps them. Okay, and Mary and Joseph, they came from Nazareth, which was a little city. Which was a little tiny village in Galilee. Okay, so we're going to say Mary and Joseph were already on their way. Is Mary pregnant? Yeah, good job. We'll put Mary and Joseph next to each other right here. She's pregnant, okay, and she's going to have a baby on Christmas Day, right? Yeah, so they're on their way. They say, come on up here by the stairs now, up by the altar. So Mary and Joseph are on their way, because today's only December 10th, right? Come on over and have a seat if you want. Okay? And they're on their way, because today's the 10th. Next week, we're going to tweak the story a little bit. We're just going to say that next week, on the third Sunday of Advent, they get to Bethlehem, okay?
That sounds good to me.
So we're going to jump them to Bethlehem next week. And then we have something really special planned for Christmas Eve. And then we have something even planned for the three kings, because we still don't know where Orient R is. All right? Okay, so Pastor right. Jacob, will you lead us in prayer, please?
Indeed. So I'm going to say a short phrase, and I invite you to repeat it back to me. Dear God,
thank you
for bringing us together,
as we travel
to Bethlehem.
Help us
share your hope
and share your love
wherever we go.
Amen.
Thank you, Becky, and thank you, everybody. Yeah.
The first scripture reading today comes from Isaiah 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak compassionately to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her compulsory service has ended, that her penalty has been paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice is crying out, clear the Lord's way in the desert, make a level highway in the wilderness for our God. Every valley will be raised up, and every mountain and hill will be flattened. Uneven ground will become level, and rough terrain a valley plain. The Lord's glory will appear, and all humanity will see it together. The Lord's mouth has commanded it. A voice was saying, call out. And another said, what should I call out? All flesh is grass. All its loyalty is like the flowers of the field. The grass dries up and the flower withers when the Lord's breath blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass dries up, the flower withers, but our God's word will exist forever. Go up on a high mountain, messenger Zion. Raise your voice and shout, messenger Jerusalem. Raise it, don't be afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. Here is the Lord God coming with strength, with a triumphant arm, bringing God's reward with God and God's payment before God. Like a shepherd, God will tend the flock. God will gather lambs in God's arms and lift them onto God's lap. God will gently guide the nursing ewes. The second reading comes from the first chapter of Mark, verses 1 through 8. The beginning of the good news about Jesus Christ, God's Son, happened just as it was written about in the prophecy of Isaiah. Look, I am sending my messenger before you. He will prepare your way, a voice shouting in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord. Make his path straight. John the Baptist was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I am is coming after me. I am not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Here ends the readings for today. May God bless us as we learn from these holy words. Amen.
Thank you, Sue. We're gonna use the media song that was used in the earlier service because it has real relevance to the sermon for today. So this is Stevie Wonder's song called "Someday at Christmas."
Track 6, drums. Track 7, clav. Track 5, vocals. Track 3, piano.
Someday at Christmas, men won't be boys. December, I shall see a world where men are free. We swing it like that.
Someday at Christmas, there'll be no wars when we've learned what Christmas is for. When we've found what life's really worth, there'll be peace on earth. And we might say, someday at Christmas, we'll see a land with no hungry children, no empty hands. One happy morning, people will share a world where people care.
So before I start the sermon today, I subscribe to a daily prayer and devotional email from the Reverend Steve Garness Holmes, who is a United Methodist pastor, and he sent this email a couple days ago with a poem called "Comfort." My people, as you light candles and sing songs, I hear your hope and longing, yes, but do not minimize the darker songs beneath that, the deep energy beneath your yearning, your grief, and your terror. I see that shadow of what you have lost, what you have done, what you fear of yourselves, the looming threat, the smoking ruins. My people, do not be afraid. My arms are around you. I murmur gently to Jerusalem, even in the throes of your fear and anger, the rage, the devastation, the unthinkable. I know, I see the splinters of the manger, the swords of the soldiers, the nails of the cross. I see them. And I am coming not to vanquish, but to comfort, to heal, to hold you, with you always, even in your despair. Be at peace. Be still enough to hear me speaking tenderly. So ends the poem. Let's be in prayer together. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts in this hour be acceptable to you, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So I always love our media team meetings. I have to tell you that we have a group of deeply faithful people on that team, and they're always willing to ask difficult questions of the text and even of their pastor. Yes, they keep me on my toes, and it's a good thing. Someone needs to. But the central question we were all asking ourselves at our last meeting is a very serious one. How do we prepare for Christmas when so much is going on in the world? Multiple countries that our own country has an interest in are engaged in brutal war and conflict. The political climate in our country in this next year's election cycle is looking more disgusting and scary with every passing day. And I don't care which side you're on of that. I would say that no matter if you're left or right, I would say that it's equally terrifying. And that's precisely why today's scripture passage is so important. Like the people in biblical times, we are thirsty for hope and we are thirsty for love in the midst of desolation and despair. We would be right to ask, where is God? But then a voice comes from the heavens so as to answer our question, saying, comfort. Comfort, my people, here is your God. The scripture tells us of the many ways that our world will be changed, that the very earth we live upon will be reformed. Valleys will be raised up, the mountains and hills will be made low, and the rough places plain. God is preparing the world for hope and peace in ways we cannot imagine. In this time of war and mourning and conflict. Then comes, I think, the most important part of the text. The Lord's glory will appear and all humanity will see it together. And we would know it when we saw it because the world would be turned upside down for the better. God is depicted as a protector and a provider for all those who are most vulnerable. God will tend to God's flock like a shepherd, feeding them so that everybody has enough, and leaving the 99 always to look for the one, and leading them along the good paths of justice and righteousness and peace and all good things. Now, anybody who reads the New Testament in light of the Old Testament will understand the coming of the Lord to be accomplished in the coming of Jesus. In the gospel reading that was prepared with this Old Testament reading we have just heard, John the Baptist is saying that someone greater than him is coming to baptize people with something greater than water. Jesus was coming to dismantle oppressive structures and interrupt patterns that disenfranchised those at the bottom in favor of a world that was more closely aligned with the will of God. Comprehensive well-being for all of humanity and all of creation. John the Baptist was saying that someday things would be better for the people who relied on God for refuge and strength. This was how the people in biblical times found hope. After the suffering and oppression they have endured, there was hope in the understanding that someone was coming to liberate them and teach them how to live in right relationship with one another in the world. So these days, there's a lot that needs to be done for our society to be the way that God wants it to be. We understand that the work that needs to be done now is similar in many ways to the work that needed to be done in biblical times to achieve that justice, dismantling the systems that provide privilege and protection for those with power equal opportunity regardless of race and gender and sexual orientation and ability. Living simply so that others may simply live, as my Old Testament professor in seminary would say. These are the kinds of things that God wills for our world. And even after all this time, I still think that God believes in us to do the things that need to be done. But in order to do those things, we need to name them. Stevie Wonder's song, "Someday at Christmas," both lives into that hope that someday things will be better and also names the things we need to do to make it so. This song was written during the Vietnam War, and it's widely considered to be the first Christmas song with a social and political message attached to it. The passage in Isaiah and this song complement each other well. Stevie sings for a world where all are free, where people are equal and nobody has to fear. The Isaiah passage says that the glory of the Lord will come near and that all humanity will see it together. That means that all of humanity will not see God's glory together until everybody has been liberated, until everybody has what they need, until all the forms of oppression which are rampant in our society are no more. The mouth of God has spoken that God wills peace and justice for all humanity. Stevie sings for a world where people care, with no hungry children. And it's not the will of God that some should go hungry while others have more than they need. It's not the will of God that the line of cars at food banks this time of year stretches for miles. It's not the will of God that people in our own communities are struggling. A world that aligns with God's hope is one where everybody has enough and we care for the well-being of each other. Stevie sings that this may not come in time for you and me. The arc of the moral universe is very, very long. Of course, the entire world won't be reformed in time for all of us to experience it. But it seems important to remind ourselves of the part we can play in making it so. We will always have work to do to achieve the kind of right relationship with each other that God wills for us. We will always have work to do to dismantle the oppressive systems that continue to inform how we live in community with one another. Someday at Christmas, with God's help, God's hope for the world will be realized. How can we respond so that someday might instead be someday soon? I don't have to tell you that it doesn't help for us to say that someday race and ethnicity won't be a deciding factor in how we treat others. Someday we will solve the hunger and housing crises in Waupun. Someday we will create greater access for disabled people. Someday women will have equal opportunities in society and in the workplace. But we can do work today that makes real lives better tomorrow or next week or next year. The only way for things to be better someday is for you and me to take real steps towards lasting change today. Like the old Hebrew proverb says, you're not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to desist from it. So in this Advent season, God is preparing our hearts to respond so that God's hope for the world can be realized. We celebrate the coming of Jesus every year and ask Jesus to show us the way. My friends, this is the way. Hate will be gone and love will prevail. No hungry children. All people are free. When that happens, the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all of humanity will see it together. The mouth of God has spoken it. Let us work together so that this may be so. Amen. Our next hymn is number 153, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Please rise if it's comfortable for you to do so. Amen. Please be seated. We now come into a time of more intentional prayer. I'd invite us to take a few moments in silent prayer as we remember the people and situations that need our prayers and our love today. And then I've got a couple of prayer requests, and then we'll come around with a microphone for anything you might have. Let's be in prayer. Receive the prayers of our hearts, O God. Amen. So I've got a couple of prayer requests. Of course, continuing prayers for Terry Meyer and for Lana as they navigate a very complicated and difficult cancer journey for Terry. God, in your mercy, receive our prayer. And we rejoice that Mark Lienhard, our outdoor custodian, is recovering quite well from his surgery. He woke up today and he was laying on his side. And Chris said to him this morning, "Do you realize you're putting pressure on your chest?" And he said, "I didn't even notice." So that's a good sign, hopefully. So for continued good recovery for Mark and for Chris as she cares for him, God, in your mercy, receive our prayer. What other prayers do we bring this morning? Okay. Anything on Zoom?
No.
Okay. Then let's be in prayer. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for gathering us together, both in person and on Zoom. We give you thanks for the reminder of what needs to be done so that the world will be aligned to your will. We give you thanks for giving us the knowledge and the tools to provide hope and love to a weary world. We ask for your continued presence to be with us as we do that work. We also ask for your presence to be with all those in need who we have voiced, either with our lips or with our hearts. For Mark and for Terry and for Lana and for all of those in need in our communities. We remember in an important way in this season those for whom food insecurity, homelessness, poverty, discrimination, and oppression affect their daily lives and prevent them from living in a world without fear. We also remember those who are in situations of war and conflict and abuse around the world and in our communities. We ask your presence of grace and reconciliation to be with them. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son Jesus, who is coming to show us the way and who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Now comes the time where we offer our gifts back to God. Here at Union Congregational Church, we give thanks for all of the gifts that are offered, whether through time, talent, treasure, or prayer. Please give generously as your heart and spirit invite you to give. Prayer of dedication. As we await your coming, dear Jesus, help us share your hope and your love through these offerings. May these offerings benefit those in our community who need our love and care the most. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 161, People Look East.
Thank you.
Before I give the benediction, just a quick reminder to all of the diaconate members that we're going to be having our meeting after worship today rather than tomorrow night. So, my friends, receive these words of benediction. Go forth in the company of the Spirit of Transformation, who does not leave broken hearts without comfort, nor wicked ways without accountability, who meets us in the garden of possibility, uprooting systems of violence, tending healing, and planting a world of vibrant interdependence. And now may the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Go in peace and go in love. Amen.